Welcome to this Christmas Eve service from Fairlawn Avenue United Church that invites us in once again, perhaps, or maybe for the first time, to the words and the music of Christmas, into this world of winter darkness and distancing comes a little light.
Thank you.
Like the shepherds, we come to the stable. Like the angels, we sing our praise to God. Like the wise ones, we offer what we have and who we are. As people of Christ, we come to celebrate God's presence in our lives and in the world.
One night, many years ago, a tiny baby was born in a little town called Bethlehem. His mother's name was Mary. His father's name was Joseph. He was born in a small barn with animals, animals of the stable standing by. He grew up to be a man who changed the whole world forever. Tonight, we remember the hope, joy, peace, and love that he brought into the world on that strange night in Bethlehem over 2,000 years ago.
Thank you.
Our story begins long before this baby was born, when there was a group of prophets. They were people who helped others understand the world that God was bringing about around them.
These prophets had strange dreams and visions. God appeared to each one of the prophets and gave them a task: to tell everyone what they knew about the future. To tell them that things might be difficult for a while, but they would get better, because someone was coming who would change the world. This is what they said.
The people who have walked in darkness will see a great light.
A child is going to be born who will save us.
People will call him a wonderful counselor, holy God, and the Prince of Peace.
At last, we have something to hope for.
What the prophets hadn't realized is that God was planning on coming to live with us as a person, a human being. When the time was right, a young woman named Mary was chosen to become the mother of this special baby, the Mother of God. Mary was very young and lived in a little village called Nazareth. She was engaged to be married to Joseph, a carpenter, who lived nearby. Early one morning, when Mary was all by herself, all of a sudden, there was a very bright light, the sound of trumpets and a rush of wings. It was the angel Gabriel, God's messenger, whose voice was coming from all around her.
Greetings, Mary. Peace be with you. You are very special, and God is with you.
Who are you? What are you trying to say?
Don't be afraid. God has chosen you to give birth to a son and to name him Jesus. He will be called the Son of the Highest, the Anointed One. He will be a great teacher and leader and will rescue your people from their suffering.
I don't understand. How will all this happen?
God has chosen you. The Holy Spirit will come over you, and God's grace will be with you. Your baby will be called Jesus and will also be known to people as Emmanuel, which means God with us. He will be the Messiah, the Savior.
Well, I think I understand now, and I would like to help. If this is what God's plan for me is, then let it be just as you say. My soul celebrates our God. My spirit rejoices in God. Our Savior has truly seen the plight of my people. Today, God brings hope to the humble. Today, God has rescued all of us. I see God loves us and will always be kind to us.
Once in royal David's city stood a lowly cattle shed, where a mother laid her baby in a manger for his bed.
Now, the land that Mary and Joseph lived in was ruled by Romans, a mighty empire. The Emperor Caesar Augustus wanted to tax everyone, so he demanded that everyone return to their homeland so that they could be counted. Bethlehem was the town of Joseph's ancestors, so he and Mary traveled all the way from their home in Nazareth. It was a long and difficult journey, but they finally made it to Bethlehem. By then, Mary was very tired and about to give birth, and she and Joseph looked everywhere for a place to spend the night.
We're full. The city's just packed with people here for the census. I'm sorry, I have no room.
I have no room in my inn. All I can offer is my barn out back where you can spend the night. They must think I'm some kind of cruel, heartless landlord, but they're wrong. I'm just an innkeeper. Well, I suppose you can call it an inn. To us, it's just a big house. My grandfather built it back when his trading business was really doing well, big enough to fit all 10 kids. A few years ago, Rachel and I were just rattling around in that big house. Our children had all grown up and left home, so we thought maybe we could take in a few travelers, make a little extra money for our retirement. We put out word, and soon folks started to come. Every night we'd have a person or two, sometimes more. Then came that whole census thing, and the governor thought up that's a way to tax us, to pay for the soldiers who oppress us. People from all over the province flooded into town that week, filled us up completely. Rachel and I slept in the main room, and we started putting guests in the other rooms, but they kept coming. So then we doubled up two or three families to a room, and they kept coming. Finally, when we had even filled the main room with four families, plus Rachel and me, we had to turn people away. I must have gotten in and out of bed 10 times that night, stumbling over bodies to get to the door. No more room. Sorry, folks. Come back in the morning. We have a couple of families leaving then. They'd mutter something and head back to their group and sleep somewhere next to a house under the shelter of a blanket. I just couldn't make any more room. It's the honest truth. But I did make room for one couple. Joseph, he was a shy man, down from Nazareth. When I said, no, I'm sorry, he told me about his wife. She was very pregnant and looked awfully pale and in pain. I knew I couldn't let her have that baby outside in the dark and cold. The barn, it would just have to do, I told myself, and I let them out back. It was crowded with animals, so I shooed some of them into the pen outside to make room in one dry corner. Joseph said, do you know where I can find a midwife? I think we will need her soon. He didn't know much about having babies, it was plain to see. I ran to Sarah's house and pounded on the door until her husband came. One of the travelers is having a baby, I told him. I'll wait while Sarah gets dressed. I stopped to catch my breath and tell her to hurry. By the time we got back to the barn, Joseph had his wife settled on some hay and had wrapped her up in a blanket used for the animals. We waited outside in the shelter of the barn for hours, it seemed. All of a sudden, we heard a cry. You have a baby boy, Sarah was saying as we peered around the corner. A new baby, a new life.
Thank you.
of that night, there was a group of shepherds who were taking care of their flock of sheep in the steep hills outside the town. They were poor men who wore rough, simple clothing. This night, like most of their nights, was cold, dark, and lonely. In the midst of their nightly watch, on this particular night, God's angels stood among them, and God's glory blazed around them, and they were suddenly very afraid.
Don't be afraid. We come bearing good news of peace for all people. A baby has just been born in Bethlehem, who is foretold by the prophets. He will be the Messiah, the Savior.
In that instant, the shepherds knew how important this baby was, and they were so grateful that the angels had come to them.
Come on, let's go to Bethlehem to see this baby, this wondrous child.
If only we had something to offer him.
We could stay the night and make sure he stays safe, just like we watch over our sheep.
Please tell us where we can find him.
This is what you are to look for: a baby wrapped in a blanket and lying in a manger. Go quickly. He will bring joy to every heart.
My father is one of those shepherds you see in the hills. He's training me, showing me how to do his work. One day, the flock will be mine. I can't wait. I'll have my own shepherd staff and spend nights under the stars. But not yet. Tonight, Mother asked me to bring him food. I had just spotted the flock of sheep up ahead when suddenly the sky above them was on fire. It was burning so bright, I ran closer. There were angels in the sky. I guess that's what they were. And what seemed like musical voices boomed off the hills, echoing back and forth. The sheep were frightened. They began to scatter all over the fields. I hugged my dog and I covered my ears, but I could still hear them. It was like nothing I've ever heard before. Light seemed to radiate from every word. When it was quiet and the light faded away, Father and the other men left their flocks and ran into town. I followed and caught up with them. They were in a stable with animals, but they were crowded around a young woman beside a baby. They were all kneeling, just staring. I didn't understand. My brother is a baby and he's nothing special. Except for the sound of hooves on the floor, it was so quiet. Then a little cry, and the woman leaned over the baby. She looked exhausted, confused. She took the baby in her arms, and then I could see him, all wrapped up, his face red and scrunched up. She said his name. They call him Jesus.
Angels, we have heard the mighty sweet singing before the winds, and the mountains in reply echoing their joyous things. Glory,
many days later, another group of visitors arrived at the stable to see the special baby. The Magi, or wise men, were a group of scholars and sorcerers of great knowledge and wisdom. They had seen an unusual, bright star in the sky. From their lofty towers in the bright cities far to the east, the Magi had seen a most intriguingly peculiar phenomenon, a new brilliant star. It had come out of nowhere and was very, very bright. As they were scholars, they wanted to understand what it meant.
Now that star is fascinating. It's not like anything I've ever seen before in all the years I've spent studying the sky.
Such an unusual size, and so bright. It must mean something.
Well, it's clearly a sign that something important has happened.
It's in the western part of the sky. If we journey in that direction, perhaps we can get closer to it.
Upon their camels, the Magi journeyed for several weeks, following the star until it stood over a little stable in Bethlehem. When they saw the baby Jesus, they fell on their knees in worship. They lay down the valuable treasures they had brought with them with which to honor him.
This child, this precious child has come into our lives that night. There in that rough, strange stable in the dark and cold night. And yet, I'm sure I heard angels singing. Maybe my memory has been colored by time or by what came after. But it seems when I look into our child's newborn eyes that night, I could see wisdom and courage. I suppose every mother sees her baby like that. But the feeling left such a deep impression. The moment felt soaked in light from within somehow. It felt holy, and I thought this is a baby for all of us. Everyone is part of this story.
This Christmas night, the hopes and fears of all the years are truly come together in our hearts, our longing for peace, for love, for joy, and for hope have brought us here on a journey shaped by yearning and expectation and in faith. In this season of expectant waiting, our Advent journey is complete. We have sought out peace in places of harmony and wholeness. We have felt the rhythm of joy that emerges from pain.
We have made room for love's power to transform and renew. And we have held hope in our hearts, hope that in the vulnerable infant Jesus, we find our promised transformation.
In the light for our darkness, we can see how God comes to us as one of us, vulnerable and filled with promise. For through the light around us, at times becoming night, still there is for one for whom even the night is as bright as the day. It is he who is born this night.
Sing me on of a savior.
with all who hear this story, with all who come to this stable, no matter who we are, no matter where we come from, no matter where we are heading, we celebrate the light of Christ born into the world, God with us.
Let us pray. Lord of light and love, on this Christmas Eve, we pause to reflect on, remember, and celebrate your love in Jesus the Christ, who is the light of our world. Grant us the will to open our spirits and minds so we can focus on you and receive the peace, the love, joy, and hope that you bring to us through the gift of your Son, Jesus the Christ. Excite our imaginations, O God, with the same level of anticipation and hope that the hearers some 2,000 years ago had when they were told of your coming. And grant us immeasurable patience as we continue to await your second coming. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Merciful Lord, Christmas for so many people will be different this year than previous years. Be with the families who have lost loved ones who they were hoping to celebrate this season with. Be with the families whose loved ones are hospitalized and are fighting for their lives. Comfort the children of frontline workers who have to adjust to a life of seeing their parents via Zoom. And those children who are suffering deeply, O God, from the loss of a parent or both parents. May these families be consumed by the warmth of the light of God. Remind us, loving Lord, that you are our comforter, that you are our healer and our counselor, and that you will never leave us or forsake us. God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Dear Lord, help us so as not to be crippled by grief and hopelessness to the point where we cannot remember the reason for this season. Instead, grant us the courage to hold on to your hope and your love. In times like these, we really need to be reminded of the reason we celebrate Christmas. So on this Christmas Eve, O God, cause us to remember the mystery, the awe, and the wonder of your miraculous coming. And may those memories light embers in our spirits, O God, that burn into full flames, flames that will emanate to people in our homes and those from whom we are physically distanced. Loving God, in your mercy, hear our prayers. And so, God, we pray these things in the name of Jesus the Christ, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father, which is in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours forever. Amen.
Let us go now with a blessing that takes us into this Christmas night. God's peace to you this night, all you who came from winter's cold to make this pilgrimage of the heart, to hear God's birth among us told, to birth God again within our hearts and spirits. and to wander with the shepherds and raise our voices with the angels, to lay at the manger the gifts of our brokenness, our hopes, and our dreams. God's peace to you this night. Amen.